Here I want to introduce the fzero function, which is useful for finding roots for single variable functions, finding them numerically rather than analytically. All right, so first let's see how this fzero function operates. So if we look in the help for fzero, there's a lot of information of how to use it. There's a lot of additional arguments that it can take. We're going to start off using it in the most simple way. So looking at the slide here, the simplest way we can use this is that fzero is going to take a function, either an inline function or an mfile function like we've been using in the previous sections, and then an initial guess of where the root or the zero of that function is. There's a couple things to think about when we're using the fzero function. First of all, if the function we're analyzing has multiple roots or multiple zero crossings, fzero only finds one of them at a time. If we want to look for additional roots or additional zero crossings, we have to rerun the fzero function. And the reason this happens is because the second argument that fzero takes is going to be our initial guess of where the location of the zero is for our function. We can only give it a single guess, but that guess is very important because depending on what our guess is could determine which zero fzero is going to find for us. Again, I'll reiterate, this is only good for single variable functions. So even though we might have functions that take multiple arguments, we have to hold all but one of them stationary in order to find where the zero crossing or zero crossings are. So let's see this in an example of how we can apply the fzero function. I'm going to go to the function we were looking at a couple slides ago. And just copy it into what we have here. So this was looking at quantity t plus a times cosine t plus b. I'm going to stick with a being 2 as a parameter and b being 1.1 as a parameter. So let me plot this. So this is what we saw before. And if we see the plot, let me make it a better color to look at here. I'll make it black. And I'll make it a little bit bigger too. So we see here that we're going to have multiple zeros or multiple roots, multiple locations where the value of y is equal to zero. So we can take a guess or get an approximation of where these are if we use the ginput function, but this is not as exact a method as we want to use, and also it's interactive. Fzero is going to automate this process. But at least we can get a rough idea to compare the values we get from fzero to ginput. We have our first zero crossing here, and then another one about here, 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 and here. If I press enter, we should have 5 zero crossings. So around negative 5.8, negative 2.7, negative 2, about 0.5, and about 3.6 should all be roots to our function. So when we apply the fzero function, we should get close to, but actually more accurate results than we got by really eyeballing it with ginput. So to use fzero, again, I already have my function y established here. So the simplest way to do this, I'll call it x0 is equal to fzero of, I'll explain this syntax in a minute here. Okay, so the first argument, again, is the function that we want to find the root of. In this case, I'll start kind of at the end and work my way backwards. The function we're looking at is y, and as I defined it above, it takes three arguments. It takes t, I'll change this to t here, t, a, and b. Before that, I'm putting the at sign of t. So at sign parentheses t parentheses. This tells f0 that t is the variable that we're going to be adjusting and seeing where the function is equal to zero, which means that even though y takes three arguments, t, a, and b, this is telling it that a is not changing, b is not changing, but f0 should be changing the value of t until it finds a zero. And then the second argument it takes is our guess as to where one of the zeros is going to be for our function. So let me start. I'll guess that I have a zero at x at t equals zero, even though I know I don't. But we can see what is going to come out of this. So I'm going to run just this line and not suppress the output. So we see here is that we found that there was a zero, or a root of our function, when t, I guess I'll call it t0 instead, when t was equal to 0.4708. And what we saw when we were using ginput is that we found pretty close to that. But again, we know in this interval, negative 2 pi to 2 pi, that there are 5 zero crossings. This gave us only one of them. There's going to be infinitely many across the entire domain because it's a periodic function with cosine here. But we can see that depending on where this guess is, we can get different values or different zeros being detected. All right, so at 0, we found one of our zeros at 0.47. If we make another guess, a different initial guess, let's say 3 here, we see that here it finds a different zero. It finds the zero crossing at 3.6. So that was another of our values. If I give it a guess of negative 6, I get that first zero crossing, or the leftmost, at negative 5.8. And then there's going to be two pretty close together. So let's say negative 2 is one of our guesses. Here we find that we cross exactly at negative 2, so it's finding this zero. And to find that last one, we have to adjust our guess. Starting at negative 2.2 is our guess. I actually found that zero at negative 2 again. So I have to adjust my guess until I can find that last zero at negative 2.67. So by changing our guess, we were able to find where these five different zero crossings are. But again, take note that that initial guess, that second argument here, impacted which zero we were finding when we were using f0. First, I'll address why is f0 useful to us. It seemed we got pretty decent results by using ginput and just clicking on where those five zero crossings were across the domain from negative 2 pi to 2 pi. And for some functions, we could find where the zeros are analytically. In this case, we could find it analytically. It would be difficult, though, because we have that cosine function, but we could find those five zero crossings. The nice part about using f0 is, one, as opposed to using ginput, it automates the process. I don't have to go and click on different zero crossings and get really what's an approximation of that value. So that's one useful thing. I can use this. I can just run it in my script, and it's going to give me a zero, or I can give it multiple initial guesses on different lines. So if I give it a couple of initial guesses here, it's going to find, in this case, give it a different initial guess, and run these two lines. It gives me two of the zeros by giving it two initial guesses. I don't have to click on it. As opposed to solving it analytically, like we see in this example, finding the analytic solution to where the zeros are could be very difficult, or in some cases, it might not be feasible to find it analytically. This is solving it numerically, again, using that initial guess as a starting point. So we didn't have to rearrange the algebra, set it equal to zero, and then take the arccosine of something. This does it entirely numerically. I'm not going to get into the details of exactly how f0 is operating, but if you are interested, it's using, for the most part, it uses a Newton's method to kind of stumble upon where the zero is. So it uses that initial point, or that initial guess that we give it, as that starting point, and it usually finds a zero that's the closest zero to our starting point, although it's not the rule that it's going to find the one closest to the starting point, so be aware of that as well. So lastly, I can augment my plot and specifically put where these zeros are. So let me make a couple different letters here. So let's have t0, t1. That was two of our zero points that we found. And keep going until we have all five of them. Oops, so when we had initial guess at negative 2, negative 2.5, we found a different zero. And the fourth zero we found if we guessed, let's say, negative 6. All right, so that was all five of our zeros. What we can do here is I'm going to add these zeros onto the plot. So let me rerun this entire portion here. All right, so I put a hold on command in the plot, that's line 70 here, so that anything I add to this is just going to be superimposed onto what we already have. Let me try a new plotting function here, scatter, which is similar to plot. It's going to just put plot points on at places that we specify. So I went to scatter here. Let me try adding t0 as our x value, and we know at the zero crossing that the y value is 0. And I'm going to add this as a specify the size, and then the color. And this should work for us. So if I run this line and I go back to the figure, we see it was very small here. Let me make it bigger. So that third argument of scatter is the size of the plot point that it adds. Maybe make it even bigger here. All right, so now we can basically see it. Let me rerun this section of code. All right, so we saw that we added that crossing where it detected it at t0. And what we should be able to do with scatter is actually give it all at once all of these plot points. All right, so those are the 5x placements of the markers. And in this case, since they're roots, or where locations where y is equal to 0, I can specify 0 in the rest of these cases. Let me actually make it one bigger one more time here and rerun this whole section of code. So if we see, when we make this a little bit bigger, that we've superimposed on the original plot, we numerically found where those roots were, and now it plotted them as green squares on our original plot.